Okay, hello, welcome. Thank you so much for coming out to the Professional Development Flipped Classroom session. Today we are going to expound on the purpose of professional development. This professional development is to inform you on how to engage our students and increase their achievement when done correctly. So flipped learning is normally unused because teachers are not properly trained nor aware of how to use it. So hopefully by the end of this session you all feel a little bit more comfortable with it and prepare to jump right in and try it out. So to get us started, similar to the KWL chart, I like the link chart. It is for L, list everything you know about the flipped learning. So you have a handout in the middle of the table. Go ahead and grab one. So if you flip it over, that very first column that you have, it wants you to list everything that you know about flipped learning. So I'll give us about 2 minutes to go ahead and just write down the things that you know. Okay, so maybe there are some questions that you have about it, which will take you over to our inquire column. So what are some questions that you would want answered about flipped learning? All right, awesome. So now that we've gotten that part out of the way, let's go ahead and share with one another what are some of those things that you want to know.
For list or inquiry?
Either way.
For inquiry, I put, how do we hold students accountable when they're not going home and doing their part, and then coming the next day and having something prepared, like ready for them to move into, if they, assuming that they did it, but then coming in and like, if they didn't, then what do we do? If they keep on not doing it, then what do we do with those
kids? A bit different, but it's kind of the same concern. How do you encourage participation? And for this, I'm assuming it always involves some sort of, usually, not always, involves some sort of technology or a task to complete at home.
Okay, good. Excellent question. So hopefully by the end of this session, we answer those questions, but if the questions are not answered, I would definitely be happy to research a little more for you all and just kind of let you all know what others have said with what works for them. So here on the back of your sheet where you first got it, this is your Flipped Classroom 101 cheat sheet. So it explains what is it with what the Flipped Classroom is, but the key question that many people kind of get lost with is how do I start it? So first we always want to determine our goal just as if we were to set up a lesson that's not going to be placed on technology. We want to determine our goal, choose the lesson that we're going to flip out of the objective that we have, then create a feedback loop, which will introduce students on feedback, being able to get them their information quickly and vice versa, and then the materials that are sent home and planned for in class time. So our aha moment will be, it's not all about the video. You can flip in school and then let students create on their own. And so some of you all, are your questions were in regards to how do we hold them accountable, or what are some issues that we have with our students? So some of them could be that they don't have technology at home. So in those cases, what I encourage and what I have seen is that we want to print, if possible, if we're doing presentation slides, so that they won't have that excuse of, oh, I don't have it at home. But not only that, we have this video that I want to share on how to flip a classroom.
Once there were two students, Susan and Ernie. Susan had a very nice teacher who taught the class in a traditional manner and assigned homework to be done the same night. This was a problem for Susan at times because she would get easily distracted and not remember much about the lesson afterward. This left Susan frustrated when trying to complete her homework because she could not do her best on it. Ernie's teacher was also very nice, but she taught her class a little differently. Instead of lecturing to the class during the day, she created a video assignment for her students to do online at home. They would take notes, watch the video as much as necessary, and come to school the next day prepared and ready to apply what they had learned. This model of instruction is called flipped learning. In a flipped classroom, the direct instruction and homework distribution are flipped. At home, students watch the lessons prepared by their teacher on their media device. Students can then take notes, practice their skills, and come to class ready to apply their new knowledge. Flipped learning also allows the teacher more time to make sure that the students understand the material and offer aid to those who do not. This teaching method also opens more opportunities for collaboration. This can help in extending each student's learning experience. The routine took just a little bit of time to get used to, but Susan's teacher gave it a try, and Susan thrived.
What if you took the traditional school day and flipped it on its head? Not literally, of course, but having lessons offered at night at home and homework done by day in the classroom. That's the experiment underway at Clintondale High School, just outside Detroit, an area still reeling from the economic and social ills of the nearby city. The school serves many low-income families and faces tight budgets and declining enrollment.
So what's the number part that I'm going to need for all three?
Just 3 years ago, almost half of Clintondale's ninth graders were failing math, science, and English. And overall school performance was ranked in the lowest 5% in Michigan.
Is this the one you want me to go with?
Yeah.
Principal Greg Green decided to take a risk.
Frankly, we weren't doing very well. And so, you know, we had to make a change. I mean, we were desperate for change.
His aha moment came while coaching his 11-year-old son's baseball team. Having learned to record and post instructional videos for his players to watch outside of practice, he was struck by how much time was then left to focus on individual players on the field. He saw the educational potential starting with the power of videos.
Kids can go back and watch them as many times as they want. And in me as an instructor or expert, I don't have to redo that all the time. And I can spend my time with the students in class and actually assisting them. And so if I could do that with 11-year-olds, imagine what we could do with 15 or 16-year-olds doing math.
Green went all in, flipping the entire school, urging his staff to rethink the use of technology and how it complements traditional teaching, and getting local businesses to help fund the effort.
So the legislative branch makes the laws.
Now, lectures are recorded and posted online.
The American Civil War lasted from 1861 to 1865.
Or teachers can assign outside videos from the popular Khan Academy and TED Talks.
Pretty small, yeah.
Students watch these videos as homework outside of class.
Why do you say it's plutonium?
In class, students now do what was once considered homework. Assignments designed to test learning comprehension. Clintondale teachers say this allows more time for one-on-one help and often encourages students to collaborate in problem solving. But English teacher Rob Damron said it took some convincing.
When we first did this,
it was funny to look around that staff meeting. I look at a lot of staff members, you know, especially the ones that have been here 25, 30 years and saying, what are you talking about? What's a blog? You know, what's a Google group? Apostrophes makes a noun show ownership or possession. For teaching for 20 years, I know what lessons kids are going to have a problem with. But I think with doing this flipped approach, there's problems I didn't even know existed. So you really can't hide back there in the corner and say, yeah, I got it. You know, and then the teacher sees later on, well, no, he really didn't get it.
One problem the school faced head on, students who can't afford or don't have access to technology outside of class. They're given extra time in the school's media lab.
Segregation before 1954.
Taking the technology-driven approach further, some lesson plans are now tailored to have students use the latest trends in social media.
Thanks to the 19th Amendment, us women have the right to vote. We deserve to vote. We deserve to vote.
Like this project that required constitutional amendments to be summed up in 6 seconds for the popular website Vine. Green says that taken all together, after 3 years, the flip is paying off.
Our ACT gains have shown, you know, doubling the national average as far as ACT gains. You know, state testing, we've had some mixed results on that. And we've also seen an increase in graduation rates to almost 90%, college acceptance rates at 80%.
Senior Darrell Wallace Jr. is one example. His grades have risen from a 2.5 GPA as a freshman to 3.5 as a senior. And he says the flip has played a big role. He now watches videos on his cell phone while taking the bus home into a rough section of Detroit, where he lives with his mother and four sisters.
I really looked at the videos more because I knew I might not have as much time at home because my sisters are in college and they need the computer, so I'm like, I can do it on my phone. And the bus ride is like 30 minutes, so I probably can get like half of my assignment done.
Daryl's mother, Sabrina Young, also likes the flipped model, saying there's only so much she can do to help with traditional homework.
Especially algebra. So him doing it at school is a plus for him and as well as me, because I just didn't remember the majority of it.
The popularity of online learning has surged in recent years, and flipped classrooms have started popping up everywhere, from elementary schools to some of the nation's top universities.
Record a video based on a lesson of yours. is because we are afraid that students will not be engaged and not necessarily want to go home and get the work done. So what he would do to answer your questions from the beginning, he had his students come in the following day after they were supposed to do the flip learning at home, and their warm-up would be their exit ticket from the flip learning the night before. So if you did not do the flip learning, then you're more than likely not going to get a passing grade. He would move those that did take it and did pass the warm-up to independent practice. And so I was like, well, Dr. Hodden, how does that work? You have these students that did not pass, and so you keep them with you and just go over all the content that you already did, but then you let the others go. How do they all end up meeting at the same point before the class period is over? So he said that once he did his work with the students hands-on, those who he had already let go to do the independent practice and the extended practice, he just pushed along his other students who normally tended to be the lower students in the classroom. Also, the idea of doing the flipped learning within the classroom was to have one group where they work with the teacher directly, another group to work with the flipped learning with their iPads, and then a third group working on the independent practice. And those that were in the independent practice are usually students that were already high and understand the information and could guide themselves. Those that were in the flipped learning station are your on-level students, and those that are with the teacher directly were the ones who were your lower students. Okay? Any other questions?
So I think my concern is that kids are coming in, and like when I tried this, they were coming in and not having their part done, and you know, even with the small group pulling the lower kids, it kind of became almost like a habit, you know. Oh, I already know that if I don't do it, I'm still gonna get pulled in small group, and it's still gonna help my grade, kind of almost like providing this scaffold. Like, yeah, it helped them in that moment for that skill, but it didn't solve the problem of like, do it at home.
Mm-hmm. And so in those cases, I would say definitely try to implement some type of incentive. So students love to be praised, and I think at that moment where you let them know, hey, those of you who did do it, this is what you will receive. And then I would suggest like allowing them to choose what they want their incentive to be. So I know myself, I can get stuck in my ways, and I'm like, I'm just giving them candy. But a lot of times, they don't even want candy. A lot of times, they're like, I want to choose my seat for a day, or I want to be your helper for a day. So half of the time, it's free, and we think that it costs to give incentives. But maybe that'll be a good solution to your problem. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Again, thank you all so much for coming.